Hey G.I. Joe fans, Joe Motion Videos 82 here. It's time for another G.I. Joe toy review. But before I get into that, I want to thank every one of my subscribers, from those of you who have been with me from the very beginning to those who just recently subscribed. I checked my subscription numbers. I'm up to 55, which I'm very proud of. It's definitely exceeded a goal that I had. And I did do a giveaway, so congratulations to those of you who did win. I hope that you're enjoying the action figures. Bjorn, I'm sure it's still en route. So let me know when you receive it. It's going all the way out to Norway. So anyway, I normally will subscribe back to you guys, but there are a few of you have chosen to remain anonymous, and I really can respect that. So you have my gratitude. I do really appreciate you guys. It feels good seeing my numbers grow. Let's just put it that way. Okay, so last week we reviewed the legendary four-wheel drive Night Attack Stinger. Hands down, it's an excellent vehicle. I think I made that point pretty clear how much I really enjoy that vehicle. It is a lot of fun. I loved it as a kid, love it even more as an adult. I have it displayed way out in the open for everybody to come and enjoy. Anytime my niece and nephew stop by, they always run back to look at my toy collection, and I'm glad that they get to enjoy it. Today, we're going to be looking at the weirder side of G.I. Joe. Let's say the weirder side of Cobra. Not that they ever got weird. No. Don't let me change your thinking on that. They never got weird at all. No, not Cobra. So starting in 1987, Hasbro took a trip to the wild side, we could put it that way, with the G.I. Joe toy line. They gave us the G.I. Joe movie. I do like it. I will review that, I promise you. I will review that. I need to watch it again and again to get some good notes down. But I can only take small doses of that. I don't want to get tired of the movie. There are a lot of neat things have been said about it. So they introduced us to Cobra Law. Yeah, they gave us these guys. Nemesis Enforcer, I would say he's number two to Globulus, and the Royal Guard. These guys aren't complete. I'm in no hurry to complete them, so I will review them eventually. Globulus, as you can tell, he's in some pretty bad condition. The only G.I. Joe that they ever made without legs. The late, great Burgess Meredith voiced him. You may know he's more well-known as Mickey from the Rocky franchise. He also played the Penguin in the original Batman series. And so he used his voice talents for Globulus, which this action figure just sucks. Play factor is shot. Nemesis Enforcer, the white eyes, kind of creeped me out. Came with these very tiny bat wings. Didn't really care for it. The only cool thing I liked were little spikes on the elbows, which he used quite often in the movie. When I'd make the action figures fight, he always throw a spike into one of their faces. But the Royal Guard, I really like this one. He's a great troop builder. It's pretty cool looking. I don't have the microphone or the antenna, which broke off the side of his head who knows how many years ago. But he's pretty cool. I like him. So they also gave us Raptor and his Falcon, which was from a long tradition of animal companions in the G.I. Joe toy line. They gave us Crystal Ball. He's complete. I will review him. I like Crystal Ball. He is a really cool character. We all know he was allegedly modeled after Vincent Price. The hypnotic shield, cool play feature. I got a lot of play time with Crystal Ball. So, it's safe to say, yeah, they did get pretty weird in 1987. So 1987 was a weird year for me anyway. I just started junior high. And that opened up a new chapter in my life, as it did with everybody else. And I did not enjoy being in junior high school. I thought it sucked. The only real good thing about it, my lifelong friend, Clint, he and I met in the seventh grade, and we've been best friends ever since. He replaced John in my life after John had moved away. So all those aforementioned action figures are the figures that people love to hate. They do have a loyal fan base. I being one of them, save for Globulus, he's, I don't know. I'll just leave it at that. Now, I like to root for the underdog, so I guess that's why I like the weirder aspect of G.I. Joe. I mean, it expanded their creativity, expanded my creativity, and that's what I really enjoyed as a kid, was to be challenged with the creative mind. I mentioned before how G.I. Joe really appealed to me because it had that military aspect and it had the futuristic aspect. Depending on what my mood was that day, could I play with them in the future, as a future collection, or as military forces? It definitely worked for me. I really enjoyed it. So, in 1988, getting into the action figure now that I'm going to review, Hasbro stepped up weirdness to a 9. Not so with Globulus. No. There's just no ranking for him. He's gone. He's out there with Pluto and beyond. Okay, they stepped up the weirdness in 1988. They gave us the Hydro Viper. Yes, yes, yes. They gave us the Hydro Viper in the long tradition of animal companionships. We had Max and Spearhead, and we cannot forget Shipwreck and Polly. And yes, parrots were used on pirate ships. So they're naturally paired with Navy figures. Pirates kept animals aboard their ships. Just a little side piece of history here, for food. And, like chickens, they either ate the chicken or they kept it for their cackle fruit or eggs, which I would think that chicken laying eggs produce more. But they also captured animals as a trophy kind of like a postcard, you know, or a trip t-shirt these days to show where you've been. So let's say they captured a macaw. Hey, I've been down in the tropics. They had a lot of monkeys. So Pirates of the Caribbean was very... period when they had Barbossa paired with the little spider monkey. They kept monkeys primarily. Parrots, yeah, they're a little harder to contain. So I got off on a little tangent, and I apologize for that, but a bit of history. So yes, birds were used traditional with the Navy, not modern Navy, pirate Navy. Okay. So before I get further in with the Hydra Viper, I just wanted to mention that Cobra loved purple. They're not a conventional army, so they could go down that road. They could be a little more unconventional. They could be more creative with their uniforms. And for that, I really liked the Cobra figures because they were real creative early on in the series. So yes, he is very, very purple. So the Hydra Vipers were released as a part of the 7th series in 1988 through 89, and then he was discontinued in 1990. He was made completely of all new body parts, never to be used again. He did not have a modern release, which I really think they should, because he is a great action figure, and I think with modern articulation, gotta articulate, they could do a lot with him, especially with the webbed hand. They could actually make it to where it could move somewhat. He originally sold for $2.55, and he was the only figure that was ever released that didn't have, that only had one usable hand. Pretty cool. Like Globulus, the only one released with a half snake body. And thank goodness they didn't go that weird. And thank goodness they didn't corrupt Cobra Commander by giving a Cobra Commander snake to us out on the toy line. He did have a slight variant. The copyright stamp, either read Hong Kong or China. I mentioned that in my quick look. He did make several media appearances in cartoons and comic books. I'm sorry, I don't have the comic book. I would have shared that as part of this review. I had the trading cards when I was younger. I was younger, as in the 90s. I bought the whole set. I was only missing one, which was Sand Scorpion. But I think I sold those to another collector for a pretty decent profit. I paid $5 for the whole brand new box, and I can't remember how much. It was considerably more than what I paid for it. But so he was on the trading cards as well. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get into the review and take a look at this guy. You can see here are just all the prime examples of the purple that was used in the G.I. Joe toy line, starting with the 85 Televiper. If you know of any others that preceded the Televiper that were in purple, please let me know. This is what I could come up with out of my collection. Then they gave us Mr. Grape Jelly Pants here. one of my favorites, Dr. Mindbender, gave. Then, you know, we got the 88 Techno Viper, very cool action figure. Then, of course, we have Voltar, another animal handler. Then we got the Night Creeper. And the Annihilator. Then the 1990 something or other Cobra Viper, which was actually the first Cobra Viper that I had purchased. I think they'd been 96 or 7 when I got him. Or later. Earlier, sorry. So it's about 94, 95. And then again, Dr. Mindbender, and why not? So, needless to say, Cobra liked to use purple as much as they did blue. And that's cool. That I really, really like that they got into that and expanded their color palette a little bit more. So, let's go ahead and take a look at the action figures accessories. He came with quite a bit of them. Oh, okay, so what his card contents call Fathom Fins, made up to look like sea monster feet. Pretty plain on the bottom. And they got away from the traditional rigid fin, and these are made out of a softer plastic, almost rubber. And they just peg right onto the bottom of his foot there. And they match the color up pretty nice. Did a good job on that. So, further down the list, which is simply called a scuba pack. This looks like it's a non-rebreather tank for extended diving. Pretty futuristic looking, very nice. It also came with two hoses, and those clipped right onto the little pins here on the backpack, for those of us who do not know. He came with a harpoon gun, which also came with our 85 Cobra Eel. This one is definitely different looking. It is not a double harpoon gun like the other one. And he came with a Devil Ray made out of this black rubber. And the reason why they call it a Devil Ray is because it has a forked tail, not a forked tail, but a point on its tail, like has been depicted with the devil. So I called him gave him a Devil Ray, which I never played with, just didn't have any use for it. And he is the first to hold this ever popular lightning dagger. Oh, this was way overused in the toy line. It came with just about every action figure in the 1990s. I cannot stand that weapon. I liked it when it first came out, but just overused. And he came with what is simply called a helmet. It is designed very well, very intimidating looking. He has some fangs down here at the bottom. He has it's painted to look somewhat like the Devil Ray. Has the arrow here on the forehead. Hollowed out eyes, which is really cool. That is took this guy an extra step and hollowed out the eyes. And they also gave him fin looking ears. Creature, the Black Lagoon looking, and it fits
very nicely on the action figure. So let's go ahead and take a look at the action figure himself. See, he's clad all in purple. Splashes of red on his right leg. He has an empty sheath, presumably where the dagger went, but it is obviously too big to fit in the sheath. Down here he has another empty sheath where a dive knife would go. He's wearing a dive vest, which is sculpted to look like scales. Sorry about that. This dive vest is very well sculpted. He has a few hoses on there, some pouches. He has the Cobra emblem right here on his upper right arm. Wristbands. He has a sculpted on dive mask with straps that go all around his head. And his head looks almost a little bit too small for the body, but that is just to accommodate this mask, which gives a pretty decent proportion. And when I purchased this guy as a kid, this is one feature I really loved: the webbed hand from the creature of the Black Lagoon looking. And as I mentioned before, that this is the only action figure that came with a hand that wasn't able to be used. So that kind of took away from a little bit of the play features on him for me. He did have the standard articulation for its time. And this is a very good example of him. I won't go over that though. We all played with them in the past. We know what they're like. The joints are very tight on him still. I loved this guy as a kid, and I still do today. So let's go ahead and take a look at his file card. Took me a while to get a hold of this. With him being a troop builder, he is the file card. They're not rare, but they can get up there in price. All right, so the upper left-hand corner reads codename Hydra Vipers, in the parentheses Demon of the Deep. He is Cobra's underwater elite trooper. Middle paragraph, Hydra Vipers are qualified eels or Cobra frogmen who volunteered to be surgically altered to withstand nitrogen narcosis and other side effects of deep diving. Nitrogen narcosis, it's also known as the bends. When we naturally have nitrogen in our lungs, but when we get down way below our atmospheric norm, which is 760 millimeters of mercury, that nitrogen gets pushed into our bloodstream and gives us the bends. It can be very deadly. You get an air embolism from it, which can give you a heart attack or a stroke or both. And it also makes you really goofy in the head. So just a little side note there. So starting after the effects of deep diving, synthetic webs are implanted between their fingers, and subcutaneous fat production is simulated by chemical injections to provide natural insulation. Okay, these guys are going to spend a lot of time in some very deep and cold water. I'm glad Cobra's at least thinking of them. The long-term effects of these procedures is known to be psychologically destabilizing. I think you're already psychologically unstable if you're wanting these effects done to you and willingly. Hey, make me a lot fatter and put some webs between my fingers. Why not? So, bottom paragraph reads, in quotes, I'm sorry these guys just aren't human anymore. They have a handshake like a dead mackerel, and they leave damp spots on the furniture. Oh, lovely. I realize that they are virtually unbeatable in underwater combat, but so is the great white shark, and I'll bet the shark is friendlier. So, more than likely, that was a quote from a member of the G.I. Joe team. And I have no doubt that Dr. Mindbender was behind the creation of our beloved Hydra Viper. Let's go ahead and hook the accessories back on. What I usually do is I hook the hoses onto the backpack first, onto the air tanks. But I did a stop motion video of Dr. Mindbender making the Hydra Viper. And just go ahead and snap that on over there, over. There we go. And then, of course, attach the fins. So the Hydra Viper is a great troop builder. I really enjoy having him as a part of my collection. So there you go. All put together and looking all intimidating and stuff.
Okay, so in closing, the Hydra Viper definitely had his speed bumps. He had the left hand that was unusable in the traditional manner as action figures go. He didn't need the devil ray. It's cool having an animal companion. Some of them make sense, others don't. Animal companionship started way back in 1984, beginning with Spirit. And I thought that was really cool. I love Spirit. He's not complete, so I unfortunately can't review him. But when I do, I promise I will review him. I thought that it was cool that he came with an eagle. I loved Freedom in the animated series. It was one smart bird. I mean, Spirit and Freedom were just a perfect animal companionship. And then we had Shipwreck and Polly. And Polly, he and Shipwreck, I think, were just the comedic relief in the show. I love Shipwreck as an action figure. I love the character. He did have a few serious moments, but most of the time he was just a goof. And I love that about him. So, the Hydra Viper for me, I'm sorry to say, he, as cool as I think he is, I have to give him a middle shelf rating. Because the play value went away, mostly because his left hand was unusable. He came with two accessories. He came with that very awesome harpoon gun. And he came with the dagger. He couldn't use them both at the same time. So I had to use one over the other. And I used his harpoon gun most of the time. I don't ever recall playing with the dagger at all. So if for display purposes, if I want to display him with the dagger in hand, there is something that FormBX257 pointed out. And so, Kevin, thank you very much for that. See the opening right here at the bottom of the air tank? He's very creative when it comes to this. Take the handle of the harpoon gun. It fits in there quite nicely. See that? And it doesn't cut too bad of a figure for posability if you want to display him with the dagger in hand. So again, Kevin, thank you. That was very creative. It's the hand and the devil ray that brought him down for me to a middle shelf action figure. If he didn't have the devil ray and it had the usable hand, yeah, he'd definitely be a top shelf figure. He really would be. He is a superb troop builder. And going into that, he is very common on the aftermarket. So don't be in a big hurry to, oh, he's rare, I gotta get out and find him. No, he's very common. Just the action figure, no accessories, file card. I've seen him go from $5 up to $8, depending on condition. As we know, condition is everything. for me, I overlook some things like the original green action figures, the green 13. I'll overlook a broken thumb because that's fairly common. O-rings, you can buy those on the aftermarket now, or you go to a hardware store, you can buy them online. Broken O-rings, I overlook, but that's just me. So $5 to $8 for the action figure by himself. Complete, I've seen him go, you know, with the file card, go from $15 up to $35. But the $35 asking price had a make better offer option. So that helped. But as I had mentioned in a previous video, that even though it has a fixed price and has a, or better offer, I've had some luck with communicating with the seller and ask if they would come down off the price, especially if it's somebody that I had done business with before, their trust has already been established. I've had luck with them negotiating a price because I was a returning customer. But as I mentioned in the video, be articulate when writing. It comes off as a little more professional. Avoid using slang, especially four-letter words, bad words. Just don't. It's not professional. And these are business transactions that you are running. And a lot of these people who are selling on eBay do it for a living. So that is their profession. So the accessories by themselves, the file card I saw go anywhere from $8 to $10. The swim fins, $1.99 each. The backpack, $2.75 to $5, depending on condition. Make sure that it has the pegs on them. Those pegs do break off easily. So make sure it has the pegs. And the air tank at the bottom where you could attach the gun, sometimes that's broken off. So at a glance, the air tank looks like it's complete. But study the pictures, ask questions, read the description. Air hoses, $1.50 each. The helmet, $2.50 to $5. Dagger, $1.99. The harpoon gun, $1.99 on up. The Devil Ray, anywhere from $2.75 to $5. Make sure he still has his tail, though. So that's something to look for on the aftermarket. The missing tail. The helmet, make sure the pegs are on the front of the mask, and the paint quality. The yellow especially has a tendency to be scraped off fairly easily. And the more prominent parts of the helmet, the ridge right here, that has a tendency to be scraped off as well. So look for that. And don't be afraid to ask questions on that as well. Some people take a magic marker or a Sharpie and color over the black area. So don't be afraid to ask questions about that especially. That would tick me off if it looked like a perfect paint scheme and I paid for it being in a mint condition or near mint. And I get home and see it, somebody ran a Sharpie over it. That would just make me mad. And they tried to pass it off as being in good condition. So, that's my review. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I unfortunately can't make it out to JoeCon this year. I was hoping to meet up with some of you guys, but circumstances come up to where I couldn't make it out this year, and last year I couldn't make it because I had moved that the same month. So Yeah, with it being the last JoeCon, that's real sad. I just hope that there's other types of G.I. Joe conventions, not just JoeCon, that will pop up here and there. Comic-Con, of course. We have a really good one out here in Arizona every year, but I've only attended that twice. I just went to the dealer's tables, but yeah, it's, I regret not being able to make it out there this year, and want to thank again all my subscribers. It is so cool seeing my numbers increase. That's telling me a lot that I'm putting out some decent content. It's not spectacular, it's decent. So thank you guys for subscribing and for giving me your time. I hope I'm at least mildly entertaining for you guys and informative. I try my best with coming up with this information. Also, don't forget about my giveaway. I have one more giveaway coming up in July to celebrate my year anniversary of being a YouTuber. The only thing you have to do to qualify is to be a subscriber. This is something that I just recently learned when I was looking up my subscribers, that some of you don't have a public profile, which I respect you wanting to keep things private. I really do. Why is it the world doesn't need to know what your business is. But in order for me to get your name, you have to have a public profile, even your screen name. It won't come up without a public profile. So even though you are subscribed, unfortunately, I won't have a public profile to pull up so I could enter your name into the drawing. But nonetheless, please don't feel that I'm not grateful, because I really am, and these giveaways are just another way of showing my gratitude. So, all that being said, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. If you don't like the video, give me a thumbs down too. I don't take it personally. I take it as constructive criticism to try harder. Share this video as well. Get some help, get those subscription numbers up for me. At every milestone, I'll be doing giveaways. And again, congratulations to my last two winners. Bjorn, it's still in the mail. I'm sure you know that. I let you know when, sent out notifications when I mailed those prizes to my winners. So, I will mail internationally if you don't live here in the U.S. It's not a problem. I really appreciate you guys, so I won't hesitate to mail internationally. It won't exclude you at all. It's just not fair that you're giving me your time and I can't include you or won't include you into a giveaway. It's just not right. So, I'll be holding a giveaway of my year anniversary then again at 150 subscribers, 200. As it goes up, I'll be doing more and more giveaways. It's just my way of saying thank you. So, all that being said, you guys are fantastic. You really are. I just recently joined Twitter. Forgot to tell you that. So look me up on Twitter. It's under my given name of Byron Kellogg. And for some reason, it wouldn't take Joe Motion Videos 82, maybe too long. But, so just look me up under Byron Kellogg and follow me on Twitter. I would love to talk with you guys. I do posts quite often, not every day, but I will make a post. I post pictures up there. posted a picture of my fourth great uncle, co-founder of the Kellogg Cereal Company. Don't see any of the money of it, though. Long family history behind that. And I found a picture online of a soldier in Vietnam that looks very, very close to my dad. I'll have to study the picture some more, but I'm pretty... It's starting to look more and more like him. So that picture's posted up there. He was a Green Beret in Vietnam. And at that time, he wasn't allowed to have pictures taken of him. So this one had to have been done either with a telephoto lens, or he just wasn't aware of it. So he was not allowed to have his picture taken at the time, because it was still top secret what he was doing over there. But yeah, bit of family history I'm proud of. So yeah, I have pictures posted online, some pictures of action figures. So yeah, go ahead, follow me on Twitter as well. So this has been Joe Motion Videos 82 signing off. You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.